And I tensed up a bit. Now, I've been in medicine a while. As far as injections are concerned, I believe it is more blessed to give than to receive. So, you know, I don't know about your dentist, but if he's trying to be sneaky, kind of putting it behind his arm like this, if you don't see it, it's not going to hurt you. But he noticed that I was tense, and he knew that I had some faith. Not a lot of faith, but a little bit. And so he put his hand on my shoulder, and he said a short prayer. God, guide my hands, or something like that. I don't remember what it was, but I remember it was like a peace came over me. Something really calming, and I thought, wow. Now, the injections still hurt, but we know that anxiety makes everything worse, especially pain. And so, from that point on, I decided that I would ask my patients if they wanted to pray. It's kind of a long story, had some ups and some downs with that, but I began to see if this was something that people wanted. And sure enough, many of my patients said they actually did want a prayer before their surgery. In fact, this was so successful that probably for about a six-month period of time, I never had a complication. And I thought that I had found the formula to perfect surgery. I thought that I would write a book about this new formula. Surgeons are always looking for formulas. If we can just find what to say, what not to say, or what to do, what not to do, we can have a perfect outcome. Well, so I was on a streak of cases going really, really well. A patient named Sam came into my office. Sam was not from the U.S. He came from an immigrant family. He was about 30, early 30s, working his way to get through nurse's aid school. He didn't want to go on welfare, so he really wanted to contribute. In the process, he began to get weaker. His arms and legs were weaker. He had a workup, and it ultimately showed that he had a cervical spinal arterial venous malformation, an AVM, which is essentially a tangle of blood vessels in the cervical spinal cord. So your cervical spinal cord is about the size of your finger, your index finger, and right about where the knuckle would be, he had this AVM, which had a large aneurysm in it, which was really pushing the spinal cord out like a ribbon around it. So the spinal cord was tremendously compressed. This is one of the risky lesions in the brain, but in the spinal cord, it's probably the riskiest lesion that neurosurgeons deal with. A very, very high morbidity from dealing with these. So I talked with him about the potential surgery. He really didn't want to have it right away, so we waited another 3 months. Finally, he was getting so weak, he really couldn't continue in school. So we scheduled the surgery. Now, it was one of those things where I recognized the risk of this case. And as I said, I was sort of moving a little bit in my faith, and so I actually asked, for the first time in my career, I actually asked some other people to pray for this case. And that was a very humbling thing for a neurosurgeon to do, to ask for prayer from other people, but it was the journey that I was on. So I went in to this surgery, and Sam also wanted prayer, so before the surgery, I prayed for Sam. We go up through the femoral artery in the leg, and we thread this little tiny tube up inside the vertebral artery, which was sending off a little feeder to this malformation in the cervical spinal cord. And the procedure involves injecting a glue that tries to close those blood vessels, close the abnormal vessels, and leave open the normal vessels that are feeding the spinal cord. It's a high-risk, high-wire act. I was very apprehensive about the case, but I was born to do that kind of surgery. This is what I love to do. And The surgery went actually remarkably well. I was able to close off this malformation using the glue and leave the normal arteries open. I got about 98% of it closed. I considered it a really technical victory. Postoperatively, I went to the recovery room, and there was Sam. And I said, "Sam, can you wiggle your fingers and your toes?" And sure enough, Sam wiggled his fingers and his toes after that surgery. And I can just tell you how intense it was, because a tear came down my face when I saw his fingers and his toes move. So relieved was I, so happy was I. In fact, I said, "Sam, we prayed before the surgery. Why don't we just stop and thank God that things went well? Can we do that?" And so we did. I went back to do some other things, but I got a call about 2 hours later, and they said, "Dr. Sam's getting weak on his right side. Can you come and take a look?" "Sure," I said. I went up, and sure enough, Sam was getting weak on the right side. Well, I wasn't sure exactly why. I figured it was probably some swelling, so I gave some steroids, thinking, well, this should go down. In fact, this could, because the surgery went technically perfectly, so whatever this is should reverse. Dr. Sam said, "What's happening to me? Why am I getting weaker?" I don't know, Sam, but we're going to give you some medicine. Should take care of it." Over the next 24 hours, Sam was totally paralyzed. He could not move his arms. He could not move his legs. Continued to give him steroids. Every time I would go into his room, I was expecting he was going to improve. This is certainly going to reverse. Because remember all of the prayer that had gone into this. And so before I left, Sam would say, "Doctor, when am I going to get better? What's happening here?" "I don't know, Sam. I don't know, but let's say another prayer." So every day I would go into Sam's room in ICU, and now the muscles of inspiration were paralyzed, so he was getting a pneumonia. Every day I would pray, and every day nothing would happen. And I remember a week later, sort of numb. I mean, surgeons get very numb when these kinds of things happen. You sort of go on autopilot. You stuff the emotions because you just have to keep going. There are other people that need your help and sort of taught in some way to be machine-like. Well, as I was coming up the stairs a week later to do my next case, I entered the preoperative area, and a thought entered my mind: "Are you going to pray today? Are you going to pray today? Because you've got good evidence that prayer doesn't work. You've got Sam down in ICU. You going to pray today?" I began to sort of think about that. Well, I had never actually prayed when I didn't feel like praying. And I had this other thought, if I don't really think prayer works and I pray, isn't that sort of being hypocritical? Maybe I should, hypocritical prayers might actually do some damage. There hasn't been a study out there. And I was getting this tension, this tug of war in my mind. I don't know if you've been in that kind of situation where you just are struggling to make the right decision. And I heard this sort of inner voice saying, "Just do the right thing." It's interesting how I knew what the right thing to do was, but I just started walking toward the next patient, Mrs. Chavez, who'd said that she'd wanted a prayer. I didn't feel anything, and I just sort of mechanically smiled. You know how you do when inside you're you're hurting, but you just smile and asked how she was and said, let's say that prayer that you wanted. So I put my hand on her shoulder. And I felt nothing, and I'd never prayed when I felt absolutely nothing. In fact, almost the opposite, just like sort of just a machine. And I just said my usual prayer, God, thank you for Mrs. Chavez, and you made the vessels in her brain, and you can help me to fix them. And I ask you for wisdom and for skill and for success in her surgery. And Mrs. Chavez was Catholic, and so I said it in Jesus' name, amen. And when I finished that prayer, I actually felt something that I didn't feel when I started the prayer. I actually felt like I had a little bit of faith. Because when we get in pain, we have what's called a focusing illusion. You focus on the pain, and that is all you see. You don't see any of the prayers that had been answered before. You just see, in fact, like you can't even remember any prayer that's ever been answered, maybe even any good thing that's ever happened to you. You just focus on the pain. Then I heard something that I had never heard before in all of my 6 months of praying for patients. Behind the curtain, the next patient said, hey, doc, when you're finished praying over there, would you come over here and pray for me? My doctor didn't pray for me. And I pushed the curtain aside. And there I saw a man who his family couldn't be with him. And he was actually an African-American pastor who, interestingly enough, every week gets up and talks to people about God. But when he's scared, when he has fear, just like me in the dentist chair, just like you when someone's coming at you with a needle or a scalpel or a letter from a lawyer, you forget that God is with you. The first thing that you forget is that God is with you. All you can see is the fear, and I am all alone. And so he just needed someone to put their hand on his shoulder and to say a short prayer and just remind him of who he was and that God was with him. And he just wept. And as I walked out of the preoperative area, I felt that God was saying to me, David, I love your childlike faith. I love the fact that you can ask me for whatever you want and that you do it. But when you don't get what you want, your response says a lot about our relationship. When you don't get what you want, the way you respond says a lot about the relationship. Well, Sam went to skilled nursing. I didn't see him again for 3 months. And I saw his name on the schedule, and I kind of cringed. See, surgeons never like to see their failures. And so if you're wondering sometimes if your surgery doesn't go so well, or someone in your family, if surgery doesn't go well, but why the surgeon is a little bit dismissive, it's because it's very hard for us to see you again and to deal with the fact that we failed. And so I saw them wheel Sam in that wheelchair by my office, and I went to the bathroom, put some water on my face, and sort of stopped before I opened the exam room door and took a deep breath and just kind of went in then and, Sam, how are you? And Sam's wheelchair, his back was facing the door, and so as I walked past him, I put a hand on his shoulder and just skin and bones, he just had withered in 3 months. It's kind of, doctor, what happened? He said, wanted to know. What happened? So I went over to my whiteboard and I drew out very carefully the spinal cord and the AVM and the glue that we used and how that just a ribbon of spinal cord and this probably some swelling occurred, and I explained it to him. I could kind of tell he was a little angry. I said, "Sam, I'm sorry that this happened to you. I never meant for this to happen. This is the last thing I wanted to happen. I'm sorry." 6 weeks later, Sam came back. Same question. "Doctor, why did this happen? Was it a problem with the glue? What happened?" Again, went to the whiteboard. "Sam, remember, I explained it to you on the board. This is the way it worked. I don't know what happened. Probably some swelling. It's a very high-risk lesion, the highest risk, these cervical spinal cord." And I just remember Sam sort of angry as he was wheeled out. I didn't see Sam. There's no reason for him to come back for a number of years. And something in me during that time said, "Why don't you go visit Sam?" Well, of course, I dismissed that. That's a silly thought. Why would I want to do something like that? That's not how it works. The patients, they come to see me. "No, I think it would be good for you to go and see what it's like to live quadriplegic while you are still in your ivory tower." So I delayed. Finally, I called Sam, who was shocked to have a call from me, and say, "Sam, I'd like to come down and visit you." "Fine," he said, "come on down." So I went down to the part of town where the bars are on the windows. And I knocked on the glass and the bars, and his sister opened the door, and I went in and thought, "Oh, this is going to be sort of like a field trip, just to see how things are. I'll learn something here." "Sam, how are you?" "Well, sort of, how do you think I am?" is what he seemed to say. Didn't say a whole lot, just had an electric wheelchair now and was getting around. "Yeah, I get out a little bit with my wheelchair." And I felt that was important. I felt like I should really apologize. Sam was angry, and I had been studying forgiveness, the power of forgiveness. And one of the things that is important in forgiveness is if someone gets an apology, the chances that they can forgive is much, much higher. Now, most of us never get an apology, but if you apologize to someone, I realized also from my research that resentment and bitterness is incredibly hard on the physical body. It makes everything worse. It steals your joy. And I realized that Sam was really angry with me. And I didn't think it was fair, because I had tried, but it was what it was. So I said, "Sam, I just want to tell you, I am so sorry that this happened to you. I never meant for this to happen. This is one of the worst results that I've had, and I feel really bad about this. I'm sorry that it happened." And Sam sort of looked off in space, like, I've heard this before. Every time I go to your office, that's what you tell me. That little voice inside said, "I want you to really apologize to Sam. I want you to take responsibility for what happened here." Well, now that's a whole other level. But I turned to Sam and I said, "Sam, I need to apologize to you because I'm the one that put you in that wheelchair. I put you in the chair. I'm the reason that you can't walk. You trusted me and I let you down." And Sam started weeping, the tears just flowing out of his eyes. He was hitting himself in the head with his hand that didn't work, called to his sister to bring him some Kleenex. I said, "Sam, if you're holding anger toward me, it's not helpful for you. and I need to ask you if you'll forgive me. And Sam said, yes, I will forgive you. And there was some cleansing that occurred there. There was something that occurred. And I said, Sam, I'd like to pray for you again before I leave. Is that okay with you? Yeah, he said, that would be fine. So I put my hand on his shoulder and I said a prayer. Sam said, when I finished, he said, you know, I feel like there's electricity going down my spine. And I said, well, move your fingers and your toes. And he said, it feels like they move a little bit better. And I thought, wow, there's something happened in here. This is miraculous. This is, you know, maybe you'll get up out of the wheelchair. But he didn't get up out of the wheelchair. He got a little bit better. He got a little bit of movement in his arm and leg, enough to help him walk on the parallel bars to start some recovery. There is something powerful about letting go. And there are a lot of reasons why we don't forgive. And everyone in this room, we pick up offenses from people. From the time we're in elementary school, we pick them up. Sometimes from our parents, sometimes from colleagues, teachers. But holding on to bitterness is like drinking poison and hoping someone else dies. It eats you up. I have found that gifted people seem to collect offenses the most. So if you find yourself having a lot of people that seem to get under your skin and offend you, it's probably because you're gifted. Whether it's jealousy, whether it's envy, whether it is just a principle of compensation in the universe, there are a lot of gifted people in this room, and therefore I know there are a lot of offenses in this room. Some of us don't forgive because we think that that person just gets off. They get away with it. Look, nobody gets away with it. Nobody has joy that lives a life that hurts other people. But the problem is, it's stealing your joy. And I want to ask you tonight, if it's stealing your joy, there may be someone that you want to let go. Someone that it takes some faith sometimes to trust that there is justice in the universe and God doesn't need your help with it. I just want to give you a moment of silence. And if there's someone that you need to forgive, I just want you to just do your own business here for another 30 seconds. Well, there's something else that I want to finish up with, and that is this. It's called the focusing illusion. And a study was done that noticed that lottery winners and paraplegics have the same problem. And it is called the focusing illusion, is when we have great gains or great pains, we tend to focus on that to the exclusion of other things that give life joy. And when we focus on those big things, both lottery winners and paraplegics, turns out that their happiness ratings plummet. They are no longer as happy as they were. Because what happens is you forget to take joy in the little things. The meal you had tonight. Maybe it was a good one. Maybe you enjoyed the meal. Are you thinking about that? You see, we get so focused on what I'll call $1,000 joy that you only get joy when the big thing comes in. Check in the mail, get a raise, relationships going well, new car. You know, when we're in high school, we get a lot of those. And when we get out into the work field, we don't always get those $1,000 joys that often. So many of us will spend time watching on the television other people getting $1,000 joys and trying to live vicariously. But the truth is, maybe you're not getting the $1,000 joy, but I wonder if you looked, if you're getting some ones and some fives and some 20s. You know, if you're enjoying the music tonight, maybe that's a 20 you could put in your pocket. You enjoyed your meal, another 20. You're actually enjoying the speech tonight. You can put a few of those in. And essentially telling yourself, I am enjoying my life. I have a good life. And this helps you with the focusing illusion. And as we in healthcare and in the upper echelons of society, we focus on the big things. And then we get the other problem with entitlement, that we are entitled to those $1,000 joys and we're angry with anyone who takes them from us. I wonder if you will focus. I want to give you a moment right now to focus on some of the joys in your life today. And start collecting those ones and fives and 20s. By the end of the week, you'll have 1,000. But you may not get the 1,000 all at once. So lottery winners, paraplegics, and everyone in between can benefit from gratitude and from noticing and being mindful and intentional about it. So I'm just going to give you another 20 seconds now just to think about putting some of those ones and fives and 20s in your pocket. Thank you. And I hope you'll enjoy the rest of the conference. It has been a joy for me to speak to you. Thank you.